Hi there, Eric Bakker, back again. We're going to talk about something not so pleasant this time. So I hope you haven't had your breakfast yet or your dinner or you're about to have it. So if you are going to have a meal, come back and then watch the video maybe later. We're going to talk about fecal microbial transplant or FMT. So this is a topic I've been following now for some time. I just saw in Wikipedia that it was first performed in 1958 in the States. But more recently, since the 1980s, it's been performed and probably likely pioneered by the Centre for Digestive Diseases in Sydney, Australia. I've had some discussions with some of the doctors at work at the CDC after a medical conference in Sydney. In fact, I had a dinner function. Not exactly something that the average person is going to sit down and have a nice meal and a glass of wine and talk about stool and implanting stool and stuff, but those things don't faze me. Part of my job. So I won't mention any of the doctors' names, but I know some of the doctors at the CDC. My personal opinion on FMT is in most cases it's not really going to have much effect on the patient. One of the doctors said that when they first started doing the pilot studies with a group of about 20 patients, after 12 months all patients had exactly the same problem that they began with. So it's not a cure-all. It was originally used particularly for Clostridium difficile, quite a nasty kind of a gut infection you can get, you know, which can lead to some serious bowel problems. And in fact, it's sort of become now the standard treatment for C. diff in America. I don't think it's covered by Medicare, so you're going to have an out-of-pocket expense, which could be, you know, many tens of thousands of dollars in some case, and sometimes any top-up treatments. But Dr. Thomas Barodi from the CDC, for example, in 1988 had a successful attempt at working with a patient with ulcerative colitis with FMT, and the patient went into remission for a considerable period of time and then relapsed. But I've worked with over 100 cases of UC, ulcerative colitis, just in the last several years, and had almost a complete remission for a long period of time using no FMT whatsoever. Just by doing stool testing, just by eliminating the main pathogens in the gut, by rebuilding the gut with probiotics, by looking at the correct kind of anti-inflammatory diet, we've got a fantastic effect with ulcerative colitis. Fecal microbial transplant, in my case, is clutching at straws. It's a last resort kind of thing that many people jump into, but now it's sort of seen like as a first resort. I think it's for really rare and unusual and strange cases where other avenues have been exhausted. But in my personal opinion, it's not required in 99% of cases. Now, I'm probably going to get blasted by saying this by some comments. I had successful FMT or I would have been dead years ago. And I'm sure there'll be people out there like that. But you'll likely be that 1% then. But for 99% of people, if those people start making lifestyle and diet changes, particularly if they did that long time ago before they developed like pathology in the gut, if those people had regular stool tests done, you know, and got on top of their leaky gut, you know, their SIBO, their candida, if all those things were slowly fixed over time, they wouldn't have fallen into the hole that they did with their bad gut. So again, in stitching time, say it's 9. So if you fix things up earlier, they don't become serious problems down the track requiring things like FMT. Now, as I mentioned, there'll be rare cases that will require it, either genetically linked cases or some serious issues there, you know. But in most cases, I just can't see the benefit. I had a case, for example, about 4 years ago. We had a young lady from the UK with a seriously bad gut. I tried many things with her, and I really couldn't get the result I was looking for. Now, the parents had plenty of money, so they flew the girl to Sydney. The girl had FMT, and for 3 months, it was all hunky-dory. Okay, if you don't know what that expression means, it was all fine. Everything went great, and this girl thought she was cured, but then bang, straight back to where she was. You know, 30 grand later, she's back in the same hole she was in the beginning. The thing that fixed that girl up was probiotics. Once we found the correct probiotics for her, literally within a month, she was back at university again. And it's as simple as that, okay? And this girl spent a lot of money going to all different clinics, tried all of the different types of antibiotics, many different things. But in the end, it was just probiotics that fixed her up, right? So it's not the cure-all end-all. To me, it's a novel technique that may work for some people. And as in Brody's case, you know, it was an expensive way to get remission, which in my opinion could have been done by using other methods, particularly identifying things in the gut, cleaning them up, and getting the patient on the correct diet. This seems to, in my opinion, to be the best outcome for most people with gut problems. And I've worked like this for decades now, and I think the results speak for themselves in most cases. So I don't recommend FMT for that reason. Maybe, well, in the years ahead, when we've mapped out the bacteria genetically to a high degree with people, and we can have more specific therapies for that patient, it might all change. But today, I don't think it's really the perfect fit for most people. That's my take on it. Thanks for tuning in.